Talking about for the last couple of weeks, time. And we've been kind of focused on the time that we go through between when there's an anointing of God and an appointing of God. In other words, from the time we find out maybe an answer to a prayer or a ministry or whatever it is that God has for us until that actually comes to pass, and how there can be gaps of time. We looked at David, who found out as a shepherd boy that he would be king, but he didn't become king immediately. It took years before he became king. And so we talked about Abraham and how Abraham processed through the time waiting for Isaac. And that sometimes we go through these times in our life where it's just hard to wait. It's hard to understand. And part of that reasoning is that God is not captured inside of time. We know that God created a heaven and an earth. We know that he created an earth that spins around a sun that makes time. And we're on that planet spinning around inside of that time. But the question is, what was time before God created a sun and a moon? There was no time. God doesn't exist in time, and that's a really hard concept for us because we do, but he doesn't, and therefore he can do things in our future and in our present and in our past because he's not captured by this thing called time. And I want to show you in Scripture an example of how God can work outside of time on our behalf. Let's go to Exodus chapter 19, Exodus 19. I want to read you this scripture real quick, and I want you to remember the things that are here because you're going to need them later. In Exodus 19, verse 18, it says, "Now Mount Sinai was all in smoke because the Lord descended on it in fire. And its smoke ascended like a smoke of a furnace, and the whole mountain quaked violently. And when the sound of the trumpet grew louder and louder, Moses spoke and God answered him with thunder. And the Lord came down on Sinai on the top of the mountain, and the Lord called Moses to the top of the mountain, and Moses went up." Not about you, but if I'm Moses, I'm really intimidated right now. Okay? I got thunder, I got a mountain quaking, I got smoke like a furnace, I got fire, and God is saying, come up here. And so we see that in this descension of God on the mountaintop, he came like fire, there was smoke, the mountains quaked, there was the sound of trumpets, the Lord spoke like thunder, and that's the glory that Moses just kind of walked up into. And during this time, he spends 40 days with God on the mountaintop, and Scripture says that God with his finger wrote out the Ten Commandments on two tablets of stone and gave them to Moses to take to the people. But during that time, God tells Moses, "I hear a sound coming from the camp that I don't like." And Moses goes down and he finds the people have made a golden calf and they're worshiping it. And Moses throws down the tablets and he sends out the priest, and 3,000 people lose their lives that day over the sin. But then Moses goes back up to the mountain again. There's another 40-day period where they rewrite, if you will, those tablets of stone. And the second time he goes up, something different happens than what happened in the first time. And it's captured in Exodus 33. So when we read Exodus 33, he's already gone up. He's already spent 40 days on the mountain. He's come down with the tablets. He's busted the tablets. And now he's going back up again for another 40-day period. In Exodus 33:13, if you got it, say, "I got it." If you don't, say, "I wasn't looking." Okay, here's what it says. "Now therefore," Moses talking, "I pray you, if I've found favor in your sight, God, let me know your ways that I may know you. Let me know your ways, God, that I may know you, so that I might find favor in your sight. Consider too that this nation is your people." And he said, "My presence will go with you, Moses, and I will give you rest. Then he said to him, if your presence doesn't go with us, don't lead us up from here. For how can it be then that I have known and found favor in your sight, if I and your people, if it's not for you going with us, so that we, I and your people, may be distinguished from all other people on the face of the earth? Then the Lord said to Moses, I will also do this thing that you have spoken, for you have found favor in my sight, and I have known you by name. Now watch this. Then Moses says, I pray you, show me your glory. Now I look at that statement, I get a little confused. He's been with God for 40 days. God is using his own finger to write out the tablets. There's quaking and fire and a furnace and all this stuff going on. And then Moses says, I want to see your glory. And he goes on in 19. And he said, I myself will make all my goodness, God says, I will make all my goodness pass before you. I'll make all my goodness pass before you and will proclaim the name of the Lord before you. And I'll be gracious to whom I'll be gracious, and I'll show compassion on whom I'll show compassion. But he said, God said, you cannot see my face, for no one can see me and live. Then the Lord said, behold, there's a place by me, and you shall stand there on the rock, and it will come about while my glory is passing by that I'll put you in the cleft of the rock, and I'll cover you with my hand until I pass by. Then I'll take my hand away and you can see my back, but my face will never be seen. Now, I don't know about you, but there are scriptures that I read and stories that I read, and I just don't get it. I don't understand how this story makes sense, because when I read it, I look at things and say, how can you ask to see God in his glory if you've been with him for 40 days already? What did you miss out on? What is it that you wanted to see that you didn't get to see? And then it says, you can't see my face. Now, God's already said you're going to be able to see the inside of my hand, and he's already said you can see the back, so you can see everything but God's face. But then again, I'm thinking when I read this, Moses never asked to see his face. He said, show me your ways that I can know you, so show me your glory. You get to see his hand, you get to see his backside, but not his face. You can see pretty much all of God. I don't know what you would see, maybe his shoulders, maybe his calves. I don't know how big he is. So all of these things are happening. Maybe it's important that Moses get to see something of the God that he's been with for 40 days. I'm confused. And if Moses is hidden in the cleft with God's hand covering him, what is he going to get to see? He's not going to get to see anything because that hand is covered until God goes by. And maybe there's some kind of importance in getting to see God after he's passed by. Does anybody ask these questions or just me? Just me? Okay, that's fine. I'm looking at this story and it's not really making sense to me. He's been with him for 40 days. He's come down. He's gone back up. And then he says, I want to know your ways, so show me your glory. And God says, okay, go in the cleft of the rock. I put my hand over. When I pass by, you'll get to see my back. Yay, I get to see the back of God, and that's somehow his glory. This thing never made sense to me until I looked at that one word. That one word, back. When God says, I'll let you see the back of me. That word in the Hebrew is achor, achor. And achor can mean the backside of something, but it also has another meaning in Hebrew. The other meaning in Hebrew is the hereafter. It means related to time, the time to come later. Let me show you. In Isaiah chapter 41, same word, achor. Same word, watch this. In Isaiah 41, 23, it says, declare to me the things that are going achor, that are going to come afterward. It's the same word. Show me the things that are come afterwards. What God is saying is, I will cover you with my hand, and when I take it away, you will see achor. You will see what's to come after. Not the backside of me, but the backside of time. What the time is after this time. Stay with me. Stay with me. So in Exodus 34, 5 through 7, we watch the event actually take place. So God's told him, this is what we'll do. And then we move forward to Exodus 34, 5, and he says, there's a recording of what actually happened. Here's how it looks. Then the Lord descended in the cloud and stood there with him. Everybody say, stood there with him. As he called upon the name of the Lord. Then the Lord passed by in front of him and proclaimed, the Lord God, compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in loving kindness and truth, who keeps loving kindness for thousands, who forgives iniquity, transgression, and sin, yet he'll by no means leave the guilty unpunished, visiting the iniquity of the fathers and the children and the grandchildren to the third and fourth generations. Now I'm looking at the actual event, and it's doing nothing more than raising more questions for me. Because now I'm looking at this and saying, okay, it says the Lord descended and stood there as he called upon the name of the Lord. Wasn't the Lord already there? It says he was standing there. Why is he still calling on the name of the Lord? He's there already. And then it says the Lord passed by him and the Lord proclaimed, the Lord God. Doesn't that seem like melodramatic that God would consider himself third person in the midst of this? I'm going to pass in front of you. Todd is passing in front of you. I'm just looking at it. I'm saying, maybe I don't really get what's going on because some of these things, they just don't fit together. I don't know. Tell you what, let me do this. Let me just change subjects for a minute. Hang on to that, but let me go to something else. The second time that Moses was on the mountain, he came down from the mountain, but something was different in Moses the second time he came down from the mountain compared to the first time. What was that? The second time he came down, his face shone. And it shone so brightly that they had to put a veil over his face. And they said anytime Moses spoke to the people, he came out with a veil over his face. And that it slowly, eventually, it faded away. But he had to wear a veil because his face was shining the second time. So we're wondering, why is it that you go up on the mountain the first time for 40 days and your face doesn't shine, but the second time you go up on the mountain and you come down, your face shines? It must have something to do with this interaction. It must have something to do with the fact that you saw the Achor, that you saw the glory of God, and somehow that made your face shine. So to try to figure out what's actually going on, I look for another example in Scripture of where someone's face shone, to see if I could connect it with what happened to Moses that would make his face shine. It's in Matthew 17. Matthew 17. Somebody just got it. You're ahead of me. But yeah, that's where we're going. So Matthew 17. We know this story as the Mount of Transfiguration. Jesus is hanging out with his disciples, and he takes three of them up to the top of a mountain, and he has this meeting on the mountaintop, and it goes like this. In 17:1, it says, 6 days later, Jesus took him, Peter, James, and John, his brother, so four of them, Jesus, Peter, James, and John, the others did not go, and he led them to a high mountain by themselves. And he, Jesus, was transfigured before them. What does that mean? What does it mean that he was transfigured? Something about him changed. Well, fortunately, it tells us what changed. It says, and his face shone like the sun, and his garments became as white as light. Now, catch this. Jesus is on this Mount of Transfiguration. He has been transformed. His face is shining. And God's voice comes out and says, this is my son who I'm well pleased in. Listen to him. And then they come down from the mountain and the thing's over. What is that about? Why did Jesus have to go up onto a mountain for God to tell everybody, this is my son, listen to him? And why did his face shine? Well, I'm going to start with why his face shines. I'm going to go to Hebrews chapter 1. Let's figure out why Jesus, when he's transfigured, his face is shining. And in Hebrews 1, it says, God, after he spoke long ago to the fathers and the prophets in many portions and many ways, in these last days, he's spoken to us in his son, whom he appointed heir of all things. Now watch this. Through whom also he made the world. And he, Jesus, watch this. He, Jesus, is the radiance of his, God's, glory. Jesus is the radiance of God's glory. He's the radiance of his glory and the exact representation of his nature. He upholds all things through the word of his power. Now watch this in John 13. John chapter 13 goes further. It says, therefore, when they had gone out, Jesus said, now is the Son of Man glorified, and God is glorified in him. If God is glorified in him, God will glorify him in himself. In other words, he will be God's glory and will glorify him immediately. So this word radiance, Jesus is the radiance of God's glory. That Greek word is apalgasma. And what it means is a reflected brightness. Jesus is the radiance of God's glory. So listen to me. If you're in the presence of Jesus, you're in the radiance of God's glory. If you were in the presence of Jesus, you were in the shining light of God's glory. Are you guys ready? Now go back at Matthew and look at chapter 17, verse 3. Who is on the Mount of Transfiguration? And behold, Moses and Elijah appeared to them talking with Jesus. So something is going on here on the Mount of Transfiguration where God shows up, Jesus is transfigured into this radiance and glory of God, and he's talking to Moses and Elijah. I don't know what this is about, because he just goes up there and talks to them, and then he leaves, and he never explains it to the disciples. And one of the things that's really unique is while he's up there, God says, "This is my son, in whom I am pleased. Listen to him." The problem I have with that is that's in chapter 17 of Matthew. And in chapter 16 of Matthew, Jesus says, "Peter, who am I?" And Peter said, "You're the Christ, you're the Son of the living God," right in front of all the disciples. In other words, all the disciples, even the ones that are up there, know this is the Son of the living God. Why is God saying, "This is my Son in whom I'm pleased"? Listen to him. Because God's not talking to the disciples. He's talking to Moses. God is saying, "Moses, this is my son. Listen to him." Let me put this together for you, because you got pieces, but let me go ahead and put it together. God takes Moses up on a mountain back in Exodus 1,500 years earlier. And Moses says, "I want to see your glory, God." And God says, "Okay, I'm going to put you in the cleft of the mountain on Mount Horeb. You're going to stand in there. I'm going to put my hand over you. And Moses, when I pass by you, I'm going to lift my hand and let you see the Achor. I'm going to let you see the time after this. I'm going to let you see the hereafter. I'm going to let you see what's in the future. But I'll protect you in the cleft, and then I'll move my hand and let you see it. And whatever it is that I move my hand that let you see makes your face shine." Why? Because he lets him see Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration. So when we're looking at the story of the Mount of Transfiguration and Moses is there, what's really going on for Moses is he's standing in a cleft of a rock and the hand has been removed, and now he's standing here talking to Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration. So he's talking to Jesus about the hereafter. He's now seeing what's going to happen in advance, what's going to happen next, what's going to happen in the future. Jesus is God's glory and his radiance. So Moses gets to see and talk with him on the Mount of Transfiguration, and it makes his face shine. These two stories are going on at the same time. 1,500 years in between, but they're going on at the same time. So he's on there. He comes down with his face shining after he talks to Jesus. Now watch this. What's he talking to Jesus about? God says, "I'm going to show you my glory by letting you see the time that comes next." And the next thing you see is you're standing in front of Jesus and you're talking to Jesus, Moses. Now what are you talking to Jesus about? Go to Luke chapter 9. Scripture tells us what their conversation was. Luke chapter 9, verse 30. "And behold," this is the Mount of Transfiguration as recorded by Luke. "And behold, two men were talking with him," Jesus, "and they were Moses and Elijah, who appearing in glory." Moses and Elijah are appearing in glory. What is glory in this case? Jesus, the radiance of God's glory. They are appearing in that glory, and we're speaking of Jesus's departure, which he was about to accomplish in Jerusalem. Are you getting this? Moses, who's back here on Mount Horeb, put in the cleft of the rock, gets told, "I'm going to let you see the Achor. I'm going to let you see the time after this." He steps out on the mountain, and he's facing Jesus, and his face is shining because he's in the radiance of Jesus, who's been transformed. And Jesus is saying what? "I'm about to go to Jerusalem, and I'm going to be crucified. And when I get crucified, all that sacrificial system will stop because I was the last one. And when that happens, there'll be redemption for all mankind to come to know God. They will all be adopted by God. Their sins will be forgiven. Moses, this is the glory of God, what he's doing in the earth through me." Now you may be sitting back saying, "Eh, maybe. Let's go back to Exodus 34. Let me show you this. This is amazing. This is amazing. You go back to Exodus 34. Then the Lord passed by in front of him and proclaimed, "The Lord, Lord God." Let's stop for a minute. Do you remember when I said the Lord descended and stood by him and he was calling on the name of the Lord? Why would he be calling on God if God was standing there? See, God is calling on Jesus. It says that in Exodus that when God descended on the mountain, it was a six-day thing where the thunder happened and the mountains quaked and the fire was there. And after the 6 days, he called up Moses. Do you know what it says? What we just read in Matthew 17:1? It says, after 6 days, Jesus took the disciples up to the mountain. Come on, stay with me. So the Lord God, compassionate, gracious, slow to anger, abounding in loving kindness and truth, who keeps loving kindness for thousands, who forgives iniquity, transgression, and sin, yet by no means will leave the guilty unpunished, visiting the iniquity of their fathers, yet he will by no means leave them, children and grandchildren to the third and fourth generations. Now look at verse 8. This is directly after Moses has had the veil removed and can now talk to Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration. Look at the next thing Moses says. Moses, he said in 9, "Now if I found favor in your sight, O Lord, now that I see your ways, Lord, go along in our midst, even though your people are obstinate, and pardon our iniquity and our sin, and take us as your possession." What did he just learn from Jesus? See, what he's saying is, God, your people are sinful. Would you please forgive us and adopt us as your children? He had just finished a conversation where Jesus said, "I will pardon their sins and they will be adopted by God." This is the next thing Moses says. He's done with that interaction with Jesus and he turns to God and says, "Will you forgive us? Will you take us as your children?" So you know what God's response to that is? The next thing God says in that conversation is, "I am going to make a covenant with you, Moses. I'm going to make a covenant for the people." Why? Because it has to be a covenant now, because Jesus will fulfill that covenant. And maybe you need a little more evidence to put these two things together. Let me ask you this. What was God's hand over the cleft for Moses? It was a veil so that Moses could not be in the presence of God's glory. What did Jesus do when he died on a cross? He tore the veil so that we could be in the presence of God's glory. Are you good if I just blow your mind a little bit more? Okay, just stay with me because we're going to go to something a little different, but it's the same thing. In Exodus 33:6, it says that Moses was on Mount Horeb when he was in the cleft of the rock. He was on Mount Horeb. Anybody remember Mount Horeb? Because there's another guy who had to deal with Mount Horeb. He was the guy that was on Mount Carmel, and he was dealing with the prophets of Baal. And he did battle with the prophets of Baal, and he had to kill them all, and he fled to Mount Horeb. And he ends up in a cave. Watch this. 1 Kings 19. So he, Elijah, he arose and he ate and he went in the strength of that food for 40 days and 40 nights. Just interesting that he's going to fast for 40 days and 40 nights. And he went to Horeb, same mountain as Moses, the mountain of God. And then he came there to a cave and he lodged there. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him and said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" Look down at verse 11. So God said, "Go forth and stand on the mountain before the Lord. And behold, the Lord is passing by." Sound familiar? "Moses, go get in the cleft of the rock. And when I'm passing by, go, Elijah, and stay in that cave, for the Lord is passing by. And a great strong wind rending the mountains and breaking the pieces and rocks before the Lord." You remember an earthquake when it descended on the mountain? Anybody? Good, okay. "And the Lord was not in that. And after the earthquake, the Lord was, he wasn't in the earthquake. There was a fire." Anybody remember fire coming down to the mountain? Yeah, good. Okay, but the Lord wasn't in the fire. "And after the fire, there was a gentle blowing. And when Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his mantle. And he went out and he stood at the entrance of the cave." He wrapped his face in a mantle. He wrapped his face in the mantle. "And behold, a voice came to him and said, 'What are you doing here, Elijah?'" I don't know if you just heard this, but the sound of the wind was on the mountain, the earthquake was on the mountain, the fire was on the mountain, and the Lord was passing by. And who else is on the Mount of Transfiguration? Elijah. Ping, 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 ping. See, I'm watching. I'm watching the little synapses go together. Listen, what God is doing is he's taking Moses in his Mount Horeb experience of being in the cliff and Elijah in his time of hiding in the cave, and he's bringing them both to the Mount of Transfiguration so Jesus can tell them what is the ways of God, what is the glory of God, what is God going to accomplish. There's a time warp going on. So when God says, "This is my son in whom I'm well pleased," listen to him, Moses. Listen to him, Elijah. He's got a story to tell you about my glory and my ways. He's going to explain this to you. And when you go back, Moses, because you've been talking to Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration, your face is going to be glowing. You've been in the radiance of God. And it's going to take a while, and you're going to have to put a veil over your face. And my hand was that veil, and that veil is over your face. And one day that veil is going to be torn in the temple, and we're going to be... Why? Yeah. No, go ahead and clap. Why do we need to know this? Why do we need to know that his Mount Horeb experience is the same thing as the Mount of Transfiguration? Why do we need to know that those things happen together? Because our God is not captured by time. Because our God is in your future right now. Our God has made arrangements, and there are times when he's going to show you the accor. It's called prophecy. Amen. It can be in dreams. Those are times when God is showing you what's ahead, and you're having your Mount of Transfiguration so that Moses could go back and say, "Oh, people, you don't know what we're doing here. What we're doing is setting up the glory of God in the future when he's going to offer his son to pay for all sacrifices and he's going to pardon all sin." Listen, if you're here this morning and you don't know the story of why Christ is the good news, why he's the gospel for us, here's why. Because God creates a heaven and an earth. And I was at a funeral yesterday having to explain this. Some people are saying, "Well, no, I believe in evolution and all this came about." I said, "Listen, I'm good with that, but here's what you have to explain to me. How did this single cell organism that eventually began to divide and split and became something, whatever it was, how did that thing reproduce itself so it could keep going?" And you might say, "Well, maybe it just did." Okay, then where did it get to a place where it decided it had to make a female version or a male version of itself in order to mate with that thing in order to reproduce? There's nothing in the entire conversation about evolution or survival of the fittest which would explain why the original male and female were created. It should have just been recreating itself. But God says specifically in Scripture, he created them male and female. Why did he tell us that? Because it's the evolutionary link that can't be explained. So we have a male and female. God creates us, puts us on this earth, and gives it to us. Enjoy this. Eat from every fruit, every tree. You know, the whole thing is yours. You can have dominion over it. I'm giving it to you. I'm just pouring out my love on you. God didn't need our fellowship. He needed to show his love. So he created us out of that love. And then he said, "Don't eat from this tree, one tree. Don't, you can have everything else, but don't eat from one tree." And I was explaining to the group yesterday that some people look at that and they say, "Well, why did God set us up to fail? Why did he even give us the option to eat from the tree and ruin the relationship?" Here's why. Because if you don't have a choice, you can't love. Here's the honest truth. If you're forced into a marriage by your parents, you don't know whether you love that person or you just had to marry them. God is giving us the option through the tree of saying, "Choose our relationship every day." But if you choose not to, if Satan comes in and deceives you and tells you, "Oh, you can eat from this tree," that's fine. You're getting deceived, and now you're serving Satan. You're not listening to God. You're listening to what Satan would tell you. And that broke the relationship with God. So now what we're doing is we're not doing the things that he called for. And I haven't said this in a while, so I want to say it again. This is not a rule book. This is a guide to joy and peace and happiness. God is setting up the ways. He is setting up the way for you to live fruitfully and prosperously and lovingly. And you say, how? I'll give you a simple example. He says in this book, if you're married, don't commit adultery. Why does he say that? Because when you do, it destroys your relationship with your spouse. Distrust comes in, takes forever to rebuild. You can't ever seem to get past it. It's always, and he was saying, look, just don't do that. Don't do that, and the marriage will work, and I'll show you how to love each other. So God creates us, gives us all of this, says, hey, stay with my plan. It's the one that's going to bless you. And we say, no, Satan's convinced us there's a better plan. I don't want to do the things you've asked me to do. Matter of fact, I want to do some things that you've told me not to do, and I'm going to find out just how much they're going to mess up my life. And what it does is it destroys our relationship with God. Now listen, here's the beauty of the love of God. From the moment it happened, God tells Eve, I'll fix this. He says, look, I'm going to one day out of your seed bring forth someone who will crush this Satan's head. Satan will only bruise his heel, but he'll crush Satan's head. What does he mean by that? He means that one day he's going to send his son Jesus in the form of a person to live on this earth and not sin. Why would that be important that Jesus came and lived on this earth and didn't sin? Here's why. Because of my sin, I'm due a condemned status. A separation from God. Why? Because I've disobeyed the guidelines that he gave me. That's why I don't have a relationship with him. But Jesus came and didn't sin. He walked it out and never went against that word. What does that give him? The right to go directly to heaven, the right to be right with God. He's not in a condemned status. Listen, if he had sinned, I get a lot of grief about this, but if he had sinned, if Jesus had sinned, he'd be in the same condemned status as you and I, separated from God. But he didn't. Therefore, he could take your place in the condemnation and give you his place in the right standing with God. Because he's not due a punishment, he can take the punishment and give you his righteousness. In other words, he'll do the exchange. He'll go in your place. I will be crucified. I'll be punished. I'll be beat. I'll be whipped. I'll take all of that on myself so that you don't have to endure it. And you will stand before God hidden in me. You will stand before God in my status, and I will stand before God in yours. And Jesus does that. He dies on a cross. He takes that punishment for us. He lays his life down. He cries out, my God, why have you forsaken me? As God is pouring out the punishment for man's sin on Jesus. And if he had been put in a tomb and we never heard from him again, he'd be just a great guy who said nice things and said, be good to each other. And then he was dead. But scripture tells us that he came back and he talked to over 500 people. Some of the people we know in scripture who said, yeah, I talked to Jesus. I record that for you guys to know for the future. He came back from the dead. Why? To show us that there's a life after this one and that he has power over it. He can get you into that new life with God. So the gospel, the good news of Jesus, is that Jesus is willing to take the punishment for all of our wrongs on himself and give you his right standing with God. See, he who knew no sin became sin so that I might become the righteousness of God in him. So the question today is, if you were going to stand before God, two funerals yesterday, okay? If you were going to stand before God, you're going to stand before God in one of two ways. The first way, God, I've been good. I did a whole lot more good things than I did bad things. I read the Bible now and then. I prayed at almost every meal. And I was just a good person, so I should get to go to heaven. And I think God would look at you and say, what did Eve do wrong? She ate one piece of fruit from one tree I said don't do, and it ruined our relationship. So it's not about how good you are. It's not about how many bad things you did compared to how many good things you did, because anything done bad is against God. Now, scripture tells us all have sinned. That's me, that's you, not a one of us are going to get through this on our own. It just can't be done. The law was put in place to show you what righteousness was in God's eyes, and God says, I knew you couldn't fulfill the law. You can't be perfect in every way, so if anything you failed in the whole thing. So I'm just kind of doomed. I've already messed up. I've already sinned. I've already separated from myself. It's over. No, because Jesus came and said, if you'll believe in me, that I took your punishment, I'll give you my righteousness for eternity. That's the good news. It's called repenting. It's called believing. It's called, God, no longer am I going to think my church going gets it. No longer am I going to think my reading the Bible gets it. No longer am I thinking my prayer gets it. No longer do I think getting good gets it. This is what I think, God, that Jesus died and took my punishment so I could stand before you as one that doesn't need to be punished because Jesus has already taken the punishment. And as I explained to the group yesterday, you're thinking, well, if I believe that, if I believe that Jesus took my punishment so I could stand before God in an uncondemned state, I could stand before God righteous, what happens the next time I sin? Do I lose it? Is it gone? Listen to me. When Jesus died for your sins, it was 2,000 years ago. You weren't even born, and he died for your sins. He died for your life. He died for all man's sin so that any would believe in him might have eternal life. This is what God is asking you today. Do you want to stand before me on your own merits? Or do you want to stand before me with the covering of Jesus Christ over you? That was the Passover, the blood that was shed. The death angel couldn't come in that house. I'm going to ask you to close your eyes for just a moment and ask yourself this question. If I die today, if I got to stand before God today, what am I going to tell him? What am I going to say is the reason why I should go to heaven or to hell? If you're saying anything other than Jesus Christ's death on the cross for me, I don't think you're going to like his answer. But this is what he offers you today. Are you willing to believe that Jesus did that for you? Are you willing to say, it's not being good that gets me to heaven, it's my belief that Jesus died for me and that he rose to show me a life after this? Hey, I want to thank you so much for joining us today in our message. I sincerely hope that God has blessed you in it. I sincerely hope that the Holy Spirit is moving in your life and planting those words in you. If you want to know more about Revive Church, just join us on our website at reviveusnow.com or come to our services at 851 Johnson Street in Stuart, Florida. We would love to get to know you. Thank you so much. Have a blessed day.